We are already in the halfway point through Burn the Witch's storyline, and there's still so much where this story can unfold in such an expansive universe that can be unravelled. It is difficult but not impossible to understand where Burn the Witch will be heading to due to the amount of information an author is giving us, but understand that this is not inherently a bad thing. With short stories like this, you usually get a lot of things tied up, or it makes sense towards the very last chapter or the ending of its storyline. Seeing as we know that Kubo made this as a hobby and created this without pressures, I would imagine that Kubo, as a writer and as an author, is very pleased about how it went. Otherwise, he just wouldn't have given it out, surely. Or the editors, even, wouldn't have passed it through. So why start a review like this? While there is an extreme minority, there are people that struggle to understand the themes and where this story is actually heading. This maybe wouldn't be so much of an issue had we not known the series' length, but because we do, there seems to be a constant anxiety and overthought about trying to understand what the story is about and predicting where it will go and how it can be done. Having this information gives us, the reader, a sense of comfortability rather than a sense of chaos. We quickly left off chapter 1 with an off-screen attack of Noelle using a spell to defeat a dragon, as it is then quickly introduced to us the governmental order, being the horns, I think it was called, yes, the horns. Even though it was one chapter, the audience really wants to see how strong gargoyles are, and it seems that Kubo, for some reason, wants to hide that fact and just leaves it to the imagination. Nothing in trailers or previews gives us a hint of power feats, which I hope will change soon. But springboarding from the last chapter, it would seem that the theme would be revolving around Balgo and how the government will be dealing with him or removing him as stated. This chapter starts off as it emphasises on Noelle and Nini's relationship even more than we're already accustomed to. And while the colour page really represents that their outward appearances are just for show in comparison to their core personalities, Kubo in fact goes to show this through many different ways. The colour page is Noelle, who is prim and proper, while Nini's is a comfortable and carefree outlook. You would expect that these personalities would actually clash, but their interactions feel almost alike each other. The way Kubo shows them eating pie, for example, is yes, they are different in their approach, but have the same intent and essentially messiness about it. Especially evident to how Noelle tries to be sophisticated, yet in fact eats a pie with a damn knife. It's not really conventional, Noelle. Didn't teach you table manners, did they, mate? Their friendship is so connected and familiar that Noelle is able to perceive what a call from Nini would be about and knows how, in her own comedic way, on how to deal with it and how to handle it, as well as distract Nini from discussion, for example using Balgo in this case. In two chapters, Kubo was able to express to us a level of depth beyond the surface level of our main characters, to which makes them relatable, understanding and realistic, allowing jokes or emotion to strike the reader. Kubo also addresses more into the dragons and its world, and while it is explained to us the difference between light and dark dragons, it is explained how society has been able to use and coexist with these different types of dragons that have already coexisted, which is kind of a question I'd always had, whether they were man-made or not. This was in fact quickly ruled out, as dragons were just given use throughout time, essentially how it would seem. This chapter would eventually then lead into what we would call an illegal dragon, or illegal dragons, which seem to be the semi-main focus of this chapter as a whole. But before I get into that segment, a truly fascinating thing to me was how Reverse London is also a mirror dimension. Every action in that world has a reaction to the parallel on the other side. If a building is blown up, for example, or erected in the real world, then it would have effect in the reverse world and vice versa in Reverse London. It is very interesting note that Nini explained how certain situations are best to be left to the police, to which makes sense. Fixing buildings or solving crimes would affect the world and society on the other side. Yet at the same time, it's fascinating to see that the civilians of Reverse London are also aware of both worlds as well. It's almost like explosions or tragic events doesn't seem to bother the civilians at all, and it's almost conditioned to them, and that these events seem unavoidable and is affected from the other side. I guess that's a weird mindset to go about it, but if there's an explosion, like, there's nothing you can do about it. If it's gonna happen, it's gonna happen. You kind of have to just deal with it, and I guess that they are in fact used to that, I would say. And you know, they can't really repair anything, because if they start repairing it from their side, then naturally, like, the other side are just gonna see a bunch of floating bricks or a building repair itself all magically and whatnot. So yeah, I can see how that would be a problem. So yeah, Nini was absolutely right. Let the police and whatnot deal with that. But let's talk about powers. For me, since the start of the series, I've always been absolutely obsessed with the powers of the witches and wizards. This is a Bleach sequel after all, and we've been conditioned to how Bleach works, so Burn the Witch had to follow, surely, some concepts and laws with Bleach. These connections to lore and concepts, for example, help us connect the dots, and I was fascinated if these witches had any kind of hidden ryatsu or magic in this case, I guess, I'm not sure. Now, what solidified it for me was, yes, they do. They don't have to rely on weapons, as Noelle demonstrates using her fingerprint to activate the difference between Front London's newspaper to Reverse London's newspaper. And I assume that the majority of people can use this skill, and seeing how Balgo either couldn't or was restricted by law, seems to be the split order between the two societies, which I hope we see more of down the road. Maybe it has something to do with the Drago toxins that civilians seem to have, like one of that other civilian had like 0.03 or something along those lines. Maybe that is essentially their version of Ryatsu, we don't know, we'll have to hopefully see as the chapters go on. So let's get into what happened this chapter. It was essentially Nini versus Macy. I mean, Macy isn't so much of the threat here, but it's really what led up to it. Macy, in a good way, is for Kubo to show us more backstory for Nini's girl group. You know, I'm not going to say the name. Salel, God damn it. The girl band. Yeah, that thing. Nini and Macy have a bit of a back and forth, and it seems that Macy got into Reverse London illegally and was given a dragon. Naturally, the question is less about the fight, if you can really call it that. I mean, she threw a desk. That's pretty much the most you're gonna get, but really more so on who gave her access to these things. This then leads to an explosion, and Bruno comes in and makes light of the fact he needs to write a written report if Nini had almost died that easily, implying that it was in fact intentional. This leaves off for a great deal of hype and tells me, pretty much right off the bat, that Macy was used as a political pawn. If the government really wanted to get rid of Balgo, it's best to do within some sort of accident, so it's not really questioned in order to do that. I would also imagine for societal reasons as well, if society essentially sees a celebrity die or they see this human get bought in called Balgo, it would seem weird if he died like the next month. I assume that's where it's going. But it's very evident to me, in order to remove Balgo, you're gonna have to remove Nini and Noelle as well to make it believable. And using Nini's associate in real London is a great story to play that off. But that's essentially just my prediction there. Overall, it's a great chapter that gives us exploration and suspense. Comedy is great, and the chapter shows us how Nini is pretty much the peak female form by getting not only the guys to like her, but also the females. So, I think it's confirmed that Nini is the best girl that Shonen Jump has ever laid eyes and witnessed. It really do be like that sometimes. So, I am going to leave it off with that. Guys, tell me your thoughts in the comment section down below of what you think of this chapter. I thought it was a banger. Next chapter is obviously going to be shorter, so hopefully, you know, we get an idea of where the last chapter is going to go, but it's going to be a wild one. 2 more weeks, guys. I hope everyone enjoyed the chapter anyway. I'm going to catch you guys next week, and with that being said, like, comment, subscribe, Discord in the description down below, and if you want to see a Patreon to the live reactions of the chapter, there is linked in the description as well, too. So, I'm going to catch you guys later. You guys, of course, have this fine day. I've been Hansen, as always, people. Peace out.